Okay, interesting. Tell me about that.
Have you traveled enough this year to kill a horse?
Yeah, I mean, I would have definitely killed a horse if I'd been riding it all this time since June. You know, we've been around the world a couple of times and been to, like, I don't know, 30 different countries since June, since the world premiere in Annecy. And yeah, we're kind of coming to our last legs right now. And
you hope not, though. Probably there's probably two or three more months you want to head on to this activity.
Yeah, well, I mean, we still have like three big territories that are coming out. So Spain is coming out, Brazil's coming out, China's coming out.
I was referencing the Academy Awards.
I know.
You were avoiding that conversation completely.
I'm still interested in people going and seeing it in the cinema. That's like my main motivation in life right now is encouraging the distributors to do the right things to get people into the cinema, because I mean, it's already been released in 30 countries and theatrically, and you know, most places it's been really a surprise success. I mean, obviously we were planning for it to be successful, but in some territories it's even exceeded our expectations, which were reasonably high. You know, but there's a couple of countries that just kind of screwed it up. So I'm spending a lot of time working with the distributors who are still going to release, because we've still got a lot to play for, you know. China's a big place. In Japan, they're like expanding out. So they started off in one high class neighborhood in Tokyo, and they're gradually expanding the cinemas. Unfortunately, I haven't had much to do with the Japanese release. I was sort of angling for an invitation, but it never came.
It seems like a natural place for this picture, like that they would appreciate the work.
Well, you know, Van Gogh's very big in Japan, and obviously, you know, Van Gogh, one of his four big inspirations, in fact, kind of the thing that sort of drew all his thinking together was Japanese prints. And at the moment, there's an enormous exhibition on the Tokyo Museum of Modern Art, and it's in conjunction with the Van Gogh Museum, and so there's lots of the original Van Goghs from the Van Gogh Museum over in the display. So, and they've been working together with the exhibition. So, yeah, the trouble is I just can't read any of the posts in Japanese. There's a lot of them. You know, South Korea's just crazy. There's just like every morning I wake up and there's like 500 new Instagrams, you know, from South Korea. But the translation on Instagram is quite random. So it's like, random gobbledygook comes out. So I don't know what's happening there.
But were you a big social media person before this film?
No, I actually, you know, this day came in 2015 where I started getting phone calls and texts from people that I hadn't spoken to for years. And I was like, this is really strange. What's going on? And then finally one of my friends said, I think you should log into your Facebook. And I hadn't actually logged into my Facebook for 6 months. And what happened was that we were actually did this recruitment video to try and get more painters to apply to join us. And we had this teaser trailer made up of material we'd already used. And it was just on our website. And one of the fans of one of the actors took it off our website, put it onto their Facebook page. And within 24 hours, there were 2 million hits. And within 3 months, there were 200 million views. So there was this like social media expansion. So then I had to learn how to use Instagram, and I still really haven't got my head around Twitter or Facebook, but Instagram is like works for me because it's just very pictorial, you know. So that's
well, you've
that's
logged good. Into your Facebook in the last 6 months, right?
Oh yeah, yeah. I after that, you know, I check it like once a week, but my social media of choice is Instagram because it's easy and image orientated, and you know, Loving Vincent's a very image orientated experience. So yes. I always like the fact that, you know, people are always combining pictures and you know, their thoughts and their comments.
You should probably have like a Van Gogh-ifier page, like some sort of thing where you can Van Gogh your pictures automatically, instantly.
Yeah, we thought about that, but that involves computers, and one of the great things about our film is it's just oil paints, you know. It's like real oil paints moving in front of your eyes, and we'll let other people try and emulate that, but it's pretty difficult, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, oil paint is just such a brilliant technology from many points of view. You know, coming from an animation background, one of the frustrations with animation, but also it's a restriction which you very often use positively, is you can't really render very detailed human emotions. So you normally have to go for a more caricatured approach. So, you know, like with Peter and the Wolf, for example, we actually had fixed heads. So, you know, there's no mouth movements, there's no eyebrow movements, and you have to find a way of bringing out the emotion with those restrictions. But really, from the beginning, one of the reasons we were interested in the stars, we thought that you could actually render, like, real human emotions through the oil paint. So you can read the emotions of the actors, you know, through that medium. And sometimes even enhance it in, you know, the way that you're using the brush strokes.
So which came first, the chicken or the paint?
The chicken or the paint? The painting a film was always where this started. So Dorota, my wife, you know, she trained as a painter. So she went to art high school when she was 14, graduated when she was 23. So, you know, she had 9 years of specialist art education. And then she, you know, needed some money, and she was working. She was getting work in animation and visual effects, and she was doing that for a few years. And then she just thought she'd gone off track, really, and she'd gone away from what was her big passion, which was painting. But by that time, she'd become very involved in film and really liked film. So she said, right, I'm going to combine the two. I'm going to paint a film. And very quickly after she made that decision, she decided that it was going to be on Vincent van Gogh. Because, you know, she actually read the letters for the first time when she was 15, went to the Van Gogh Museum when she was 16. She was very emotionally moved by the letters. She did her dissertation in her early 20s on the link between creativity and mental illness. And so, you know, for her it was quite logical to reach out and explore Vincent as a possible subject matter for bringing his paintings to life to tell his story. And actually, Vincent is pretty much the only painter you could do that on. So it was the first choice, but it was also an inspired choice because, you know, Vincent painted his entire world. So he painted his bedroom, he painted his shoes, he painted the view from his bedroom, he painted his food, the person serving the food, his postman, his letters, you know, the views around where he lived, the night cafe that he used to drink in, the brothel. So you can get a very complete picture of his world from his work. And also, his work's just so personal, you know? It's, like, intensely personal. So if you're bringing his paintings to life to tell his story, then that is closely connected. You can't really tell the story of Vincent van Gogh without telling the story of his journey and struggle as a painter, you know? And likewise, it's hard to tell the struggle without the paintings. So they fit together.
And technically, is there a trick, or is it just that you're basically doing what you do with cell animation with oil paint?
Well, it's different from cell animation because cell animation has a lot of different stages, different specialized departments that go into making the final image. You know, so you have one person who does like keyframe drawings, then you have someone else who's in betweening those drawings. You know, then it has to get transferred, or used to have to be transferred onto celluloid, and then someone, you know, colours it in, and then you shoot on a rostrum camera with different layers. Whereas with us, you know, it's all done by one painter on one canvas, so each shot. I mean, you know, we had to prepare the reference material, and that was kind of laborious. But when it came down to the animation, you had a painter sitting in front of a canvas, looking at the reference material and doing it frame by frame. So all that you see in the film are photographs of oil paintings, and you know, we did 65,000 frames of oil painting, but that doesn't mean we have 65,000 paintings. Unfortunately, that would be great. Because each shot was done on one canvas.
Right.
So, you know, you do the first frame, and then let's say that just the shot is me looking over there at something, then that's 1 second, that'll be 12 paintings done on the same frame. So as long as there's nothing changing in the background, they'll paint the first one, you know, which would take them up to 2 days to paint the first frame. And then they would rub out the face, and then repaint it like that, rub out the face, repaint it like that, So they're destroying their previous painting. Wow. And they're doing that. Whereas,
do
you know,
enjoy that destroying their work. To...
Yeah, I think they did actually. It's like, you know, it's like, a lot of them said that they learned to be less precious about painting as a result of this. And a lot of them have said that, you know, they thought that the experience of working on Loving Vincent has definitely improved them and toughened them up as painters, because, you know, they paint much faster now.
Right.
'Cause you just go through this experience where you're just painting every day, day in, day out. And painters don't normally do that. They normally like think, sketch, work out what they want to do. You know, maybe start doing a painting, you know, think about how they want to develop it and come back to it. And you couldn't be like that on this production. It's like, you paint, you move on, you paint, you move on, you know. And also, they were paid per painting. So, you know, you don't want to hang about too much.
So they're paid by frame, I guess?
Yeah.
By each. And so, what was the entry test? Or was there one?
Yeah, of course. I mean, you know, we could not have done this film unless we had, like, amazing painters. You know, we couldn't really find animators who painted to the level we needed in oil painting. We had 125 painters in the end, and five of them had actually done animation courses and had were trained in animation as well. But the vast majority of them, you know, they came from a fine art oil painting background. So in total, we had 5,000 applications from around the world, and we invited 500 people to do an audition. And the audition was 3 days long.
Wow.
And they had to do a painting animation shot over 3 days to see how much they could do and if they could keep it in the style and keep the control of the brush strokes, animating the brush strokes. And then out of those 500, we chose 125. I think maybe it was 130. And they then went through our intensive training system. So, you know, we had to train our entire workforce, whereas on previous films I did, you know, you just get showreels in and you hire the best people.
Right.
Whereas with this, we actually had to train them. So they did at least 100 hours in training in Van Gogh painting style and at least 100 hours in painting animation training. And then we let them loose on our production. But we had like six supervisors for the who were working under Dorota.
Uh-huh.
And at the beginning, every single frame had to be approved. And then as people became part of the production and part of the style, you know, we trusted them to, we only had to have every other frame approved. And then for some people, we just checked in on them like once every 2 days, really. So one time that didn't work out, and Dorota saw something that someone had been doing for 4 days and was like, okay, Wukesh, you've got to go back and redo all of that.
Mm.
And, you know, he went home, disappeared for a couple of days, made a voodoo doll of Dorota, and and then came back refreshed.
He came back with two ears, I assume.
He came back with two ears, yeah. No, we didn't manage to lose any limbs or body appendages as part of the production.
So was the, was the style or the method or the process or whatever something that Dorota worked on and figured out herself what it should look like, or what is the...
Well, I mean, she came up with the whole idea of how it should look like.
Right.
And she was telling me about it, and then I was like, well, you know, I mean, she'd done some tests herself, but really we knew that she couldn't paint the whole film.
Right.
If it's a feature film, it'd take her 80 years, so...
Should animate like a series of scenes just to figure out how to,
yeah,
what
she,
the process was.
Yeah, she did some early tests, but we knew that the if this was going to work, she was going to have to be able to train oil painters to be animators. So
mm-hmm.
In 2012, we did like a teaser trailer, like a concept trailer. Where we were the actors instead of actors,
mm-hmm.
and we had like white bed sheets instead of green studio.
Uh-huh.
We hired four very good oil painters, and then they were like our guinea pigs. If we could train them to become animators,
right.
For the concept trailer, then we knew that our concept of taking painters and reskinning them as animators was going to work. So that was 2012, and the results of that concept trailer gave us confidence to do the film, basically.
Well, I'm trying to get down to the raw, like, the first time somebody went, and I assume it was her, and went and figured out how the brushstroke should move across the page, how to go from frame to frame, changing the face or changing whatever they were to, you know, like those, were those things she...
Well, in large part, she had that in her head.
Or is that something you can just, you know, as an animator, how to do that kind of stuff?
Well, she's a painter and an animator, so, you know, I mean, she knew in her head, like, how she wanted to do it, you know, but then, obviously, she had to do tests.
Right.
And
she got the results she wanted eventually?
So from, I think, even from our concept trailer, it was very close to, it's a bit rougher and ready. I mean, I can send you a link to it. It's like, it's rougher.
I hear there are 2 million views on Facebook.
That was a later iteration. So this
put this one on, you get another 2 million views.
Oh, it's already on there, but it never got to those heights. But I mean, if you see it, you can see it's kind of rough and readier than the final film. But definitely, there's still that same kind of excitement in terms of you're seeing oil paint moving before your eyes, and you know, it's got crappy actors like me in it rather than good actors like Douglas and Jerome and Chris. Yeah.
So when it was time to go get actors, what was that? What did you tell them, and what did they say?
Well, it was actually a really painless process casting, you know, because we had fixed budget, we had fixed time. It's like we're going to be shooting then, you know, we've got this tiny budget, we don't need you for very many days. Would you do it? And the actors, they read the script. And we had very positive responses to the script from actors. They liked their roles and they liked the overall script. And then, you know, I think they were all fascinated as to how it would look and how they would look as Van Gogh paintings. And so the hardest part to cast was Dr. Gachet. I mean, you know, often older male parts are kind of difficult to cast on a budget, because, you know, actors by the time they get to that age are kind of, they've been through a lot, and they, you know, they've done a lot of like short film, you know, low budget films for love, and but also, like, you know, the painting is this extraordinary painting, and Vincent said he wanted it to express the heart, he wanted the picture to have the heartbroken expression of our time. So we needed to find someone who could really have this very, you know, serious, melancholic, heartbreaking expression. And it was only, I think, 2 weeks before shooting that we found Jerome. And, you know, I had heard of Game of Thrones, but I think I just watched the first season. And in the first season, Bronn is like a small character. And Dorota hadn't seen it at all. But as soon as they sent us his photograph, we're like, that is Dr. Gachet. You know, and he's just brilliant in it. And so so it was pretty painless, and a lot of the actors asked me, they're like, should we do anything differently because it's being painted? And we're like, no, you know, there's nothing you need to do differently, you know, you just need to bring out the performance of your character, you know, as truthfully and as emotionally as you can, and it's kind of up to us to then work on how that gets reimagined into the painting style.
Does anybody look not like they looked? Was there anybody who you reconsidered as artists, or is it pretty much the actors look like the actors? Because the famous actors
look like the famous, actors. Yeah, that was always the idea, is that you would recognize the painting and you'd recognize the actor. And guess Idiot Boy, you know, he's the one who's like the most fantastical character. But he's still, if you met Joe, you could recognize him, and he's like, actually enjoys the name of the role. So it's like, yeah, I'm Idiot Boy, in Loving
Proud Watson. Moments.
Yeah, proud of that. So, no, with the actors, not really. With the background actors, sometimes, you know, we kind of change them to be more like the Van Gogh sort of characters that have no spines, or you know, have funny dimensions. But it was very important to really bring out the performance of the actors. That was like the core of the challenge for the painters.
I imagine you guys know as much about Van Gogh's paintings as anybody in the world at this point.
Well, there are two senior researchers at the Van Gogh Museum who definitely know a lot more than I do still. But I can give pretty much art historians.
But I mean more like the actual paintings, like the actual Because I mean, it's funny. It's when I do these interviews, one of the things I do is pull a frame for the front of the, you know, for the YouTube or whatever, and it's all, you know, looking through somebody's face, frame after frame after frame, trying to find the frame that works, and is the smile too much or whatever. And I imagine when you look at his paintings, the detail you look at them to do this.
Yeah. Well,
it must
be
very, you know, find things that you didn't realize were there for, you know, most of your life.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, we looked at the same level that
Is that just white noise, the phone ringing?
Yeah.
I think that's very cool. It just went, what was that?
It's a thunderstorm.
It's a thunderstorm, okay. I thought maybe it was like a TV at the end of the night in the old days.
No. but it's quite relaxing. So what was I saying?
You found things in the picture.
Well, I mean, definitely. I mean, we did an enormous amount of research. We worked with the Van Gogh Museum since 2013. I read over 30 books on Van Gogh, like the famous biographies from the 1920s all the way through to the ones that were still being published while, you know, we were working on the film. So that was history was more my kind of area to check out. And Dorota and Piotr was our head of painting animation. And the two of them spent just endless amounts of time studying the brushstrokes, studying the paintings. So, like, the Van Gogh Museum sent them all at very, very high resolution so we could blow them up so that, you know, we could study the brushstrokes at these kind of size. They knew it from that point of view. And I think our combined knowledge of Vincent and his paintings is pretty high. I mean, you know, I have managed to embarrass a couple of people who run museums, so that was fun. But they're definitely they weren't people at the Van Gogh Museum, because the guys there they really know a lot about Van Gogh.
So now that you've done this, do you have movies about Van Gogh over the years? Or do you have favorites, or do you have ones that you thought were good but maybe aren't so realistic anymore?
I think, you know, if we thought that someone had made, like, the definitive Van Gogh movie, we wouldn't have made this film. So
there are a lot of Van Gogh movies.
There are, and you know, and we watched them, and we thought, well, one of the things that's really missing is that the paintings are props,
right? You know?
And that's always frustrating, I think, especially with an artist like Van Gogh, where his work is so central to his story. And so we knew that we could do something that those films can't do, which is really tell the story through his paintings. And that's what people love. I mean, people, you know, love his paintings, they love his letters, they're fascinated by his tragic and life story and inspired by his struggle.
But if you're going to watch one of those movies again...
Which one would I watch?
Is there one you go, that's the one you should... After you've watched Loving Vincent, if you want to see another movie about him, what would you watch?
Well, I mean, for me, Simon Sharma's Power of Art, the documentary that he did, extended documentary, is the best one on Van Gogh. If I was going to watch one thing, and it definitely it was I think more like emotionally involving than the big feature films. Lust for Life, you know, some of the secondary performance, like Anthony Quinn's fantastic as Gauguin. And the sets are just to die for. I mean, they're beautiful, big Hollywood, top level production design. But you know, I'm not really a fan of the Vincent. You know, that's like Mad Vincent is not what I think that the world, the story that I wanted to tell. I mean, you know, when you read his letters, he's incredibly intelligent and articulate and sensitive and sometimes even funny. You know, I think that the films have really concentrated on his weirdness as an individual. And we wanted to concentrate on his, you know, his inspirational, the fact he's an inspirational artist and his humanity. And obviously there's a pretty dark story in there. But he lived a pretty dark life, so we couldn't really avoid that.
So did anybody, with all these artists and all this stuff, were there people who became specialists in I mean, like in a normal animated situation, you would have people do different characters and things like that. Was there anybody who became like the best person at doing Theo or the best person at doing?
Absolutely. I mean, you know, we had two broad categories. We had the Vincent van Gogh painters, and we had the black and white painters who do the flashbacks and the black and white oil painting style. And then in amongst the Vincent painters, you know, we had people who specialised in Margaret Gache, and Adeline Raveau, and Dr. Gache. Pretty much everyone had to learn how to paint Armand Roulant, because he's pretty much in every shot in the film. So everyone, like, in training did Armand Roulant and something else. So some people specialised in the animation transitions, so between shots, with freehand painting animation transitions. Other people specialised in landscapes. Other people specialised in the moving camera shots, which were the really hard, hard shots to do. I mean, you know the one where we come down from the stars at the beginning, Starry Night? The middle section of that, you know, when we're coming down into the town, that was taking Bartosz, it was taking him 2 weeks to do 1 second.
Wow.
So that, yeah, that is you, when you watch that opening shot, that's 18 months of... so it's 6 months of three people's lives that you're watching in that one opening shot. But, you know, we wanted something spectacular.
Because it's expansive or because it's more detailed? Or
yeah, well, essentially he's having to repaint it each frame because it's the moving camera moving down from the heavens all the way down to Earth. So he's, each frame he's having to repaint Starry Night a little bit lower, a little bit lower, a little bit lower, a little bit lower. And luckily he's a very zen person, so it didn't send him totally off the wall. And then we had people who specialized in the nighttime paintings, and you know, and we had pretty much one guy, Wukash Gucho Gordon, who he did most of the nightmares shots, because it kind of suited his style. So I mean, that was really one of the hardest things, was to schedule the paintings between the 100 painters, and make sure that you had the right painter doing the right shot that was going to suit their talents, was going to therefore suit the film, and also just trying to work out when they're going to finish the shot, because you know, some people were almost twice the speed of other people, or even more, like three times the speed of other people. So you'd always have to try and work out, you know, when are they going to finish it? Because for some people it would be 2 months, for other people it would be 4 months. And so you've got to think a long way ahead in terms of what's going to happen. And then you might have it that if someone's 10% faster, then it screws up your entire plan. But that was just one of the fun things about it. I can send you like a video of us scratching our heads doing the scheduling. It's kind of fun. We had this like giant wall that we called the Weeping Wall, and it was 5 meters long and 6 meters long and 4 meters high, and we had up every shot on this wall, and a big ladder like they have in those libraries, just like
sliding across.
Yeah, changing it all.
It is. I think the producers on shows like this, on animated movies, are the kind of unsung heroes of animation world, because it is remarkable when all those pieces and all, you know, and you know, you guys were all, I guess, in one place doing your work, but a lot of these shows are spread out over the entire planet waiting for stuff to come in.
We made a very conscious decision not to do that. So we did have a small painting unit in Wrocław, which is the other side of Poland, and we also had a small unit in Athens in Greece, but the almost all the people were based in our one studio, and you know, that made the financing harder, because you know, I refused to have to have units in other countries,
which would get you
you know, to leverage support from there, because I just thought, you know, to make a film like this, we just had to have it completely under our very tight control. Particularly as, you know, our budget was $5.5 million, which, while that might be a reasonable size budget for a European animation film, if you're painting every frame of a film, it's a very small budget. So that was another reason why we wanted to keep it, you know, very, very tightly under our control.
Is there anything that's harder than other things? Are the eyes more difficult in these kind of things, or is it just each animator had their, or each painter had their style and their skill, and at a level which That was just part of
I mean, every single one of our painters could come in here and paint you exactly as you look now, like completely. Is they're at the level that they can paint anything that they want, you know.
It'd be such a waste of their time. So particularly like right it. Now, I'm not looking at my best, but whatever.
So you've got a little bit of a Pear Tanguy about you now at the moment. So it's the same pose as his in for his iconic painting.
Yes.
What we could do is we could do faces, emotions much better than in any other form of animation. I mean, in animation, like, you know, very often you stylize and you exaggerate to bring out an emotion in different ways, which is one of the fun things about animation. But, you know, for a story like this, it's very much about the detailed, you know, the subtle emotions
right.
on the faces of the actors. So that was easier. I mean, the thing that's harder is that, you know, it's just slower. I mean, for Pete and the Wolf, Magic Piano, you know, my puppet animation films, we were doing 2 seconds of animation per animator a day, which at the time I was like, I want to do live action. This is so slow and frustrating. What
and
do I do
you
next?
Lower, yes.
You know, we invented the slowest form of filmmaking ever, because our average was a third of a second per animator per day. So 6 times slower than puppet animation, which, you know, many producers just reject out of hand for being too slow.
Yeah.
So that was very difficult. Moving cameras was very difficult. So, you know, we had to, especially on our budget, we had to choose very judiciously what was moving camera shots. You know, very often, I'm one of the producers as well, but my two producing partners would be like, I'm pretty sure this doesn't need to be a moving camera shot. And we would rush like, we're pretty sure it does, you know. So we did have fights over every single moving camera shot, because they could be up to 10 times as expensive as you know, a locked off camera. I mean, that's fine. I mean, it's sometimes frustrating to us, but on the other hand, it's good. It makes you really think about if you need it. So sometimes restrictions are good in filmmaking.
It is interesting, though, because you're, you know, in a movie set, it's, you know, how many days and how many hours and how much light and all that kind of stuff. But this really is a choice. Every choice you make is an absolute choice.
Yeah, you know, that's another great thing about animation is that you do have complete control over the canvas, if you like,
yeah.
and your restrictions normally budgetary, and sometimes I watch animation films, and particularly CG animation films, and now that you can do anything, can move anywhere, you know, I kind of feel that it was fun to begin with, and then you need some rules to the world. It's like you can't necessarily just fly around everywhere with like a camera flying all over the place, moving at, you know, high speed and
I
have
think that
no
came out this weekend. It was called Justice League.
I haven't still even seen it.
I'm making fun of it, but
so,
I am told.
Okay, fine.
There's a lot of crazy CG, you know, just giant stuff.
Yeah.
That you get lost in because it's just so much giant stuff.
Yeah. So you know, I think it's good even if you're doing like a fantasy film or you know, a film about ghosts or something. You still need to sit down and go, what are the physical rules of this world? You know.
Well, like Dragons or How to Train Your Dragon. Part of, you know, I think what works about those movies is that they're a very strong set of rules.
Yeah, they think about the you know, the weight and the dynamics and
not overly fantastical.
And that pays off, I think.
Yeah, it's critical. For me, it was when CG started being able to do eyeballs. That was when I kind of like, but you can't do them for a whole film normally.
Yeah.
But when they started doing the effect shots, like in Pirates of the Caribbean,
yeah.
And they actually, instead of, you know, building everything around the face, they actually rebuilt the face.
Okay,
we're going somewhere else now.
It's like
in another world. But then you do it in mass, you see like something like Jungle Book.
Yeah.
And it's hard to get, it's not the Uncanny Valley anymore, but it's, eye contact is very difficult to do if you're animating it.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
But in this film, you feel emotionally
every
character.
Yeah, and that's oil painting is just an incredibly sophisticated artistic medium that was developed over hundreds of years, and you know, kind of the pinnacle of oil painting, I think, was, you know, the impressionists and the post-impressionists, and then, you know, most talented people went into to other things, you know, maybe into music or into film, mm-hmm. and so you know that kind of golden age where people were really innovating and they were going out of the studios into the plein air and really challenging kind of the accepted order in relation to what was being painted, just really moved it to a very sophisticated point. And so it was really exciting for us, you know, to be able to use that technology and combine it with film technology. And so, you know, I think we'd definitely think about using oil paints again, because it's slow, but it's you have very fine control over what you're doing. And it, the great thing is it's so obviously handmade, you know. Right. It's like when you look at it, you can see the paint dripping, you know, kind of moving in front of you. And I mean, I've made CG films, but, you know, the mediums of animation that I liked was always the ones that felt like you could touch them. Mm-hmm. So that's why I always liked puppet animation, is that you had a very tactile kind of feel. And you know, what I think appealed to me about oil painting animation is, again, the sense that you can sort of reach out and touch the canvas. And, like, coming into the studio, you can, but, you know, you don't want to ruin the painting, you know.
Except when you want to ruin it and move to the next one.
Exactly. Yeah. Destroy it each time.
Of course, now it's IP. You now own a piece of IP in Hollywood, because you're the only one who does oil painting animation.
Yeah. So
you guys are now a brand that has to be maintained, and you need sequels. And
well, hopefully, you know, this film will mean that people will pick up the phone and ask us to do more oil painting animation films, because that'll be fun.
Have you guys thought of other artists who would be interesting, or do you have to do an artist, or?
Well, we're thinking about doing a painted horror film. We're big fans of kind of art house horror film, and it was one of the things that relaxed us. We did for fun and relaxation to take our mind off Loving Vincent, and we're thinking about doing it, basing it on the late paintings of Goya, which are pretty dark, and we after we finish this tour, then we're going to go and sit in the Prado Museum in Madrid for 3 days and kind of soak up his paintings and see if we get inspired. We were awarded a little bit of money to develop this, so we're going to develop that. We're actually thinking of doing a couple of live action films as well, just because, you know, each painting animation film is a big commitment, you know. So it's like you're talking about half a decade of your life at the minimum. I mean, you know, this time around it'd be quicker for us because we'd already developed the talent base, we've got the infrastructure, we built all the painting animation workstations. You know, a lot of our painters keep contacting us and saying, when are you going to start working on the next one? We're bored, you know, we want to come back. So, but also it'd be good to do some films that were turned around a little more quickly.
So when did you see, when did you see something close to will be the locked film? How long was it happening as you went? Were you?
Well, I mean, in terms of the story, it was like after we finished the live action and we were preparing like kind of very basic references for the painters as well. Right. We edited the film at that stage. And we were editing for 6 months.
You're editing the live action for 6 months.
Yeah.
And then once you had that, was there? I mean, how?
Well, then emotionally, the story was there, you know.
Okay.
But I mean, there's a big difference when you see the live action with green screen and you see the final film.
I would say.
But you know, we'd already done, you know, for example, we shot the Pear Tanguy character 3 months before we shot John Sessions 3 months before we shot everyone else, because we're just going around in this catch-22. It's like people were going, well, what's it going to look like, you know? So we couldn't close our finance. So one of our financiers, you know, kindly said, well, look, I'll give you a big chunk of change and go and like shoot part of the film. And then let's show it to people, and then we did. So
how much was that? How many minutes was that of the film?
We did about 20 minutes of the film. So we did 20 minutes of the film, and we immediately started painting it, and then, you know, showing that was kind of crucial to us being able to move forward and plan the rest of the shoot. But you know, in animation, it's very normal that you edit the film at the layout stage, or in our case, the live action stage,
right.
And you try not to like change it too much because it costs a lot of money to change it. So there was only two instances where we painted shots and then we cut them out because, you know, you're talking about 3 months of someone's life there. Right. But you know, in film, story's always king. So you know, if it's if your story's going to be better, if your film's going to flow better, if you cut something out, you cut it out.
But I mean, when you saw the first time you saw an hour, say, of the film, the way it ultimately is presented,
yeah,
did that feel like, this is, I mean, seeing even 10 minutes of it or 20 minutes or whatever,
yeah,
it's probably a different feeling than seeing an hour of it.
Well, for me, it's like, you know, seeing it, I don't want to give stuff away, but, you know, when you get up to the sad bit with Vincent, which is kind of like 25 minutes into the film, I think when I saw the first, because we prioritized doing that first, and I mean I was showing that to people and they were bursting into tears, and you know, it was having a very profound effect on people, so definitely, it was good to see a chunk of the story, and also I think it was good because, you know, if you see like a trailer or individual shots, you're just thinking, wow, that looks cool, that looks different.
Right.
And when you can see more than 15 minutes, the great thing is you forget about the painting in a way. You just concentrate on the story, mm-hmm. which is what we needed. We needed people to be obviously fascinated by the visual at the beginning, but at some point they need to just really connect with the story, and then occasionally they'll go, oh, okay, yeah, it's a painted film. But you know, I mean, if you look at a lot of our posts, a lot of people are going to see it twice. So a lot of people are saying, well, I really loved it, but next time I want to go and just watch the story because
right.
I was too busy watching the paintings.
Yeah.
So I think a lot of
people... I'm just trying to figure out, I guess, whether it's like Hitchcock, and he was kind of like, you know, all the prep and everything up to the day of shooting was really what he loved, and then getting the shooting right was obviously critically important, but he felt like he'd already kind of made the movie.
Yeah.
And now just getting the cattle to move through the scenes, sets.
Yeah.
Did it feel like that at all? Like you were,
by the
time you were painting, that was obviously emotional, but...
No, because, you know...
You knew what you were going for?
We story-wise, we knew what we were going for, but we still had a huge way to go in terms of the look. And you know, Hitchcock probably said that when he was already, like, blasé about working with just incredible actors, whereas, you know, this is a feature debut for me and Dorota, so... I often had situations on the set where an actor was delivering our lines and I was like, he's changed my lines, they're too good, I don't remember that, and then I'd read them, they were my lines, but they were so much better when they acted it out than it was even in my head, you know, so you know, they were bringing value to it that I didn't know was there, which was great. And also we still had a long way to go once we shot on green screen. You know, you've got like little figures going around in the sea of green, so there's a big process to go from there to it looking like it finally does.
Right.
So, but in terms of the story, you know, I think we were very fixed on the story by the time we came to the live action shooting, because it's normally in animation that you do everything in layout. Me and Dorota had done all the voices ourselves and acted the entire film out and put it to temp tracks from Clint Mansell, because we knew from the beginning he was going to be the composer. He just didn't know it, but we did. The story-wise we knew it, but there was still like a lot to play for kind of visually, in terms of how it all came together.
So when the film finally locks, what is your emotion?
But for me, the film never locks until it's finished. So I mean, for me, it was only after the grading that it felt finished, and it was very strange because, you know, me and Dorota, obviously we're married, we live together, and throughout the 5 years of working on the film, we had this list of like life after Loving Vincent, because our life was completely subsumed to this film.
Right.
So we would always make a list of all these things we wanted to do, and we were really looking forward to finishing the film. But then, when we finished the film, then we actually kind of went mad. So it's like we thought there would be all these things that we would do, but we were so I think one we really missed the studio. You know, went from having like 100 people around us to sort of be two of us on our own with our dog and a cat in a derelict house in a very, very cold winter in Poland. So, and the second thing is, even though we liked the film, you know, I think we were still worried that when it came out, people would look at it and go, well, okay, so what, you know. And it was only really Annecy at the world premiere. And we sat down and said, this is amazing 1,000 seater cinema, completely full. And while it's going on, all I can hear is people coughing or maybe snoring or you know, fidgeting in their seat. And I'm like, this is terrible. And we get to the end of the film and you know, they start applauding. And I'm like, okay, it's going to be all right. It's probably all right. You know, this is respectable. They keep on applauding. Everyone stands up. We had a standing ovation for 11 and a half minutes, which was very emotional. You know, the Russell was in floods of tears. You know, I shed a tear or two too. And then everything changed after that. But I think there was just this period between March and June where we'd finished the film and we just, the nearest we were to mad was in that period. And I think it was just that anxiety about whether people would appreciate all that work and whether we just like misjudged it and done something that wasn't going to really appeal to people. And so, you know, the very, very, we had, you know, well, we've been up for 11 audience awards and we won 9 of them at festivals. So that reinforces our feeling that you know the audience is loving the film, and obviously.
Okay, who beat you?
What?
Who beat you?
In the other two.
Yes, I know you know.
I know in one of them. Yes.
Okay.
So in one of them, it was a feel-good film about. It was in Poland, uh-huh. It was kind of a live-action festival. But we were like the token animation. We're the first animation ever to be in competition at this festival in 42 years. And we came second because I saw the scores, but the one that came first was about a guy who'd been like a drunk drug addict and he had cleaned up his act and won the Iron Man for Europe. So sort of like a rehabilitation Rocky kind of story.
It sounds like you'd do that in oil
so
paint.
I think it's a crowd pleaser, so I haven't seen
he was
it
clearly
yet.
Sniffing oil paint. That was his thing.
Yeah.
There was oil paint involved in all of it.
So, yeah, it's all got some substance abuse in there. So.
Is that a crushing loss when you come in second and you're, like, after winning and winning and winning and winning?
Yeah, it's kind of annoying. I still feel a little sore about that, but then you know.
But then you have the other 9 awards to give you love.
Well, I think it's more because it was our home country. But then, right. But then you know, in Poland, it's done spectacularly well. So it exceeded our. I think we would have been super happy if we got 100,000 admissions at the cinema, and right now we're getting close to 500,000 admissions. So. Yes, it's I have no bad feelings about losing that audience award really because the response of the public in Poland has been just incredible.
They like you. They really really like you.
They're really proud of that we made this in Poland. You know, I mean, I think you know, it's not necessarily that Poland is any more Van Gogh lovers or more sophisticated in any way. I think you know, people really went out to see this because they were proud that it's the first ever fully hand-painted film, feature film, and it was made in Poland, and so there's definitely been some kind of national pride there.
Mm. But not just in Poland. They kind of like you everywhere.
It's going, yeah. I was super happy with the results in the Netherlands, obviously, because it being Vincent's home country, and you. I was kind of worried that maybe they were Vincent out, you know. They'd had too much Vincent, but no, they can't get enough of him.
Never have enough Vincent. That's
no.
Right.
So,
maybe
yeah.
Maybe we can do Anne Frank next.
Anne Frank, yeah, so that could be one. But we've had some great ones like Finland, you know.
Yeah.
Like little tiny country Finland, and it's... It's a big hit in Finland, and Italy was the best, obviously, because they did this something different in Italy. They only released it for 1 week.
Huh.
And they basically did this whole media campaign, which was, if you want to see this film, it will only be in cinemas for these 3 days.
Wow.
And we're like, what are they doing? You know, it's like, and there's only going to be in cinemas for 3 days. As a filmmaker, that's not what you want to hear.
Right.
And then we were number one. On those 3 days, we were number one in the whole of Italy. We beat Blade Runner, which had come out 2 weeks before, for the 3 days, and it was a huge success. So they knew what they were doing.
And the food is so good.
I know, but you know.
Did you guys do that trip?
No one's invited us to Italy. Oh no, they did, but we sent painters instead.
Okay.
Because it clashed with other things we'd already agreed to do.
So you need
a
trip to Italy, a trip to Japan. We're gonna hook you guys up.
I think it's time for the painters to go out and do the interviews instead of us. We've been traveling for 6 months, and maybe Brazil, I don't know.
Somewhere where you can get on the beach for a while.
Yeah, in fact, to be honest, if we get invited anywhere hot during the Polish winter, we will be there because it's pretty cold and miserable in the winter. So
that is an excellent endorsement. Thank you for your time. I appreciate it.
Pleasure.
Thanks.
Ah.
Ta-da.
Here we go.